From Simon & Schuster Audio, Dark Sun, The Making of the Hydrogen Bomb. Written and read by Richard Rhodes.
The war was over. The troops were coming home. Sick of mud and olive drab, of saltwater showers and sweltering holds, 12 million American soldiers and sailors counted their service points to see how soon they could ship out for Brooklyn and Ukiah and St. Joe. Tens of thousands of warplanes, ships, tanks, artillery pieces sat abandoned, soon to be junked. The Second World War had been the most destructive war in history, obliterating 55 million human lives. In the end, out in the Pacific, two planes carrying two bombs had given an emperor descended from a god reason to surrender. The war was over. It was hard to imagine there might ever be another. Louis Alvarez, an American experimental physicist, a tall, ruddy Californian with ice blonde hair, had understood the message of the bomb on his way back from Hiroshima. As the time to deploy the revolutionary new weapons approached, Alvarez had found a way to justify flying the historic first mission. The scientists were confident the Hiroshima bomb would work, but it had not been tested. To determine its efficiency, Los Alamos needed to know its explosive yield. So Alvarez had invented a device for measuring that yield, a set of parachute-deployable pressure gauges to be dropped ahead of the weapon itself that would radio their readings to a backup plane. Riding in that backup plane, a B-29 named the Great Artiste, Alvarez saw the bright flash of the Hiroshima explosion, watched its pressure pulses register on the oscilloscopes mounted in the rear compartment he occupied, felt the two sharp slaps of direct and ground-reflected shockwaves slamming the plane like flak explosions. He moved to the window then and searched below while the plane circled the rising mushroom cloud. I looked in vain for the city that had been our target. The cloud seemed to be rising out of a wooded area devoid of population. On the intercom, the pilot confirmed that the aiming had been excellent. Alvarez could not see the city because the city had been destroyed. This terrible weapon we have created, Alvarez wrote home that day, may prevent further wars. Major General Curtis LeMay riddled a different oracle from the ashes of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. A swarthy, burly, taciturn 38-year-old Ohio-born engineer, LeMay commanded the B-29s that had firebombed Japan to destruction, lifting from the vast coral runways of Guam, Saipan, and Tinian like the thousand silver throwing stars of a warrior god. LeMay still remembered vividly, would remember all his life, how unprepared the United States had been at the beginning of the war. We came into the war with practically nothing, he told an interviewer in 1943. To an audience of fellow Ohio State alumni later in 1945, he would insist starkly, we tottered on the brink of defeat for 2 years before we could strike back. I know the feeling of our men besieged on Bataan and Corregidor, because I commanded a bomb group in England in the early days of the war where we found the same situation, 50 bombers against the entire German air forces. There came a time when we could see that at the existing loss rate, with no reinforcements, the last B-17 would take off to bomb Germany within 30 days. Fortunately, that unhappy day never arrived because the first trickle of help came just in time. If the Soviet Union had been the United States' Second World War ally, it was also the only possible enemy to survive the general destruction, with sufficient military power to challenge American hegemony. The Red Army occupied the eastern half of Europe. The United States believed it had a trump card in the atomic bomb, but even that advantage was a wasting asset. On September 19, 1945, while Curtis LeMay and two of his colleagues flew nonstop from Hokkaido to Washington, proving that atomic bombs could be delivered great distances by plane, physicist Klaus Fuchs, a member of the British mission at Los Alamos, was delivering information about the atomic bomb by hand to a courier for Soviet intelligence. Fuchs had been passing information on the atomic bomb project to Soviet agents since 1941. In October 1945, with Fuchs's information and information from other U.S. and British spies, the head of Soviet foreign intelligence in Moscow was able to supply Soviet scientists with a detailed plan of the plutonium implosion bomb. The war was over. The atomic arms race had begun. In 1939, when word of the discovery of nuclear fission in Germany reached the Soviet Union, a young nuclear physicist named Igor Vasilievich Kurchatov was well positioned to guide Soviet research into the extraordinary new reaction. Kurchatov was an exceptional physicist, son of a surveyor and a teacher, born in the pine-forested Chelyabinsk region of the southern Urals. He was young for the job, but he was a natural leader, vigorous and self-confident. One of his contemporaries said, "I was always struck by his great sense of responsibility for whatever problem he was working on, whatever its dimensions may have been. At the same time, there was nothing pedantic about him. He would throw himself into things with such evident joy and conviction that finally we too would get caught up in his energetic style. He was the liveliest of men, witty, cheerful, always ready for a joke." Kurchatov organized the initial Soviet study of nuclear fission at PhysTech, the Institute of Physics and Technology in Leningrad. Down the street, at the Institute of Physical Chemistry, Yuli Borisovich Haratan, the youngest son of a St. Petersburg journalist and an actress in the Moscow Art Theater, began exploring fission theory. Haratan remembers, "We made calculations of nuclear chain reactions, and we soon understood that on paper, at least, a chain reaction was possible, a reaction which could release unlimited amounts of energy without burning coal or oil. Then we took it very seriously. We also understood that a bomb was possible." In March 1943, in a first report on the espionage information supplied by scientists in Britain, Canada, and the United States, Kurchatov wrote, "It is necessary to mention that the material as a whole shows that it is technically possible to solve the entire uranium problem in a much shorter period of time than our scientists believed before they were informed about developments in this field abroad." Long afterward, Yuli Haratan asserted that one should not overestimate the importance of the Soviet intelligence community in setting up the atomic program. It was true, as Haratan wrote, that it was the results of earlier research by the Soviet scientists themselves that put them in a strong starting position when they embarked on a solution to the atomic problem. But based on Kurchatov's own documented responses to the espionage material he reviewed, one should not underestimate the importance of espionage either. Robert Oppenheimer wrote in 1931, "I think that the world in which we shall live these next 30 years will be a pretty restless and tormented place. I do not think that there will be much of a compromise possible between being of it and being not of it." Many thoughtful men and women felt that way in the decades between the two world wars, and for some of them, communism seemed to promise a solution. Time magazine essayist and communist agent Whitaker Chambers observed, "In the West, all intellectuals who become communists do so because they are seeking the answer to one of two problems, the problem of war or the problem of economic crises." But commitment to communism was also always personal, Chambers emphasized, the resolution of a crisis of faith. His decision to become a communist seems to the man who makes it as a choice between a world that is dying and a world that is coming to birth. Partisan observers then and since have ridiculed such commitment, judging it naive or even delusional, but it was no more so than any other religious conversion seen from outside the circle of faith. For committed communists, it followed that the Soviet Union was the new world's vanguard. Some acknowledged its unparalleled violence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.